Good morning. My name is Jonathan Sherboneau, and I'm a co-chair of ICR 15. I hope you're as excited as I am with the launch of CanMeds. To be quite frank, after 4 years, I'm really pleased that it's finally here. And if I have to take one more teleconference on the topic, I'm not sure if I'll be able to handle it. We're gathered after our launch to now introduce our second plenary debate. It's a two heavyweights in medical education arguing the pro and the con of competency-based medical education. Before we get started, of course, some reminders to discuss online using the hashtags you see here so that our community that are not present but following by live streaming can also be participating in our conversations. And there has been a lot of discussion online, as you can see. The trash talking, I suspect, will only get worse. So on that note, I guess the appropriate phrase is, let's get ready to rumble. I'm not going to do the whole catchphrase, because I don't want that preserved on the internet forever. Our intent today is to discuss in an authentic way what are the positives and what are the potential challenges of competency-based medical education. And so it's with my great pleasure to introduce our debating heavyweights. In the red corner, we have Dr. Mark Walton, postgraduate dean at McMaster University and an award-recognized educator in the area of resident duty hours and the future of medical education in postgraduate medicine project here in Canada. Dr. Walton will debate the con side. In the blue corner, we have Dr. Holmboe, an internist and vice president for milestones development at the ACGME. Dr. Holmboe has research interests in the area of interventions to improve quality of care and methods that evaluate clinical competence. Dr. Holmboe will be arguing the pro. So without further ado, let me call the heavyweights from their corners and to hear how they present.
Gentlemen,
I expect a clean fight. AV will handle it for you.
Okay, well, good morning. My job is to tell you why CBME is so totally awesome. I have no disclosures, but I just want to make it clear I am not John Cleese.
Bill control level back.
I also want to thank Mark and John for this opportunity to participate in this debate, and I want you all to know that I'm going to be totally mature about this. So why are we so interested in competency-based medical education? Well, here's the primary reason. CBME focuses on public needs. In the seminal 2010 report from Frank and colleagues published in Lancet, they made the point that for the last 100 years, our curriculum were mostly designed through expert consensus, attached to some objectives, and then some assessment was done in a smaller measure, usually mostly around tests of knowledge. But the reality is, medical education should serve the health and healthcare needs of our populations and our regions. And it's from there that the competencies and outcomes should flow. And the last thing that you should really do is develop the curriculum and assessment programs, because they need to match and meet the needs of the competencies and the outcomes. And what are the outcomes of importance? Well, I think the triple aim's a really good place to start. The health of a population, the per capita cost or value, and the six quality experience of care aims, that care should be safe, effective, patient-centered, efficient, timely, and equitable. And at the end of the day, the core competency, regardless of what framework you're using, should be to provide patient-centered care. All roads and logic models in medical education must end here. So how are we doing with regards to quality, safety, and patient-centered care over the last 30 to 40 years? Let's take a look from 1983, shall we? If you can play the phone. Okay.
It's a bit bare in here today, isn't it? Yes. Yes, more apparatus, please, nurse.
The EEG, the BP monitor, and the AVV.
Yes, certainly, doctor.
And get the machine that goes bing! And get the most expensive machines in case the administrator comes.
That's better. That's much, much better. Yes.
More like it.
Still something missing, though.
Patient.
Yes.
Where's the patient?
Anyone seen the patient?
Ah, here she is.
Bring it over here.
Mind the machine.
Sorry, Dr. Spence.
Come along.
Come on.
Jump on.
Hello. Now, don't you worry.
We'll soon have you cured.
Leave it all to us. You'll never know what hit you.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
So let's examine quality of care after birth. These reports from the Commonwealth Fund, the World Health Organization, and the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development over the last 10 years highlight the persistent and pernicious problems in both quality and safety in the developed world, let alone what's happening in the developing world. And what about care at the end of life? Let's consider the journey of Mary. Mary is a 77-year-old woman with a history of heart disease and recurrent lung cancer post a lobar pneumonectomy, who was recently diagnosed with bronchitis. Mary's made it clear she doesn't want additional cancer therapy, despite several courses of antibiotics prescribed by three different physicians, all of whom are board certified and did well on psychometrically valid exams. Mary feels worse, having to stop frequently and to rest and catch her breath. Mary's very frustrated with her oncologist and primary care physician because, quote, they just aren't listening to me. I feel more tired and short of breath, and they don't seem to talk to each other. Finally, the primary care physician orders a chest CT scan that shows her cancer has advanced with bulky mediastinal adenopathy. The primary care physician refers Mary to a surgeon to perform an endobronchial biopsy to, quote, guide possible palliative therapy. Mary is confused about the need for the biopsy, having previously declined additional therapy. After 8 weeks of multiple physician visits with three physicians, Mary can barely get out of bed and has lost all appetite. Her elderly husband and children finally intervene independently and institute home hospice care directly. On initial hospice evaluation, Mary is severely hypoxic and confused. Oxygen medications are ordered to comfort her and to reduce her anxiety from shortness of breath. Mary dies at home 7 days later. Her biopsy was never performed, and none of her physicians were engaged in her hospice care. And so with all this data, are too many of us affected by the syndrome nostalgiaitis imperfecta profunda? Does anybody seriously want to train as Samuel Shem did in the book House of God, which were based on real events? Oh, and by the way, I made the mistake of sharing this book with my mother. I'm not sure she ever really recovered from the shock. In 1984, Jay Katz wrote assembled a book about the dysfunctional communication patterns between patients and physicians, around the same time that Harold Beckman showed that physicians will interrupt the patient after just 18 seconds of starting an interview. And in 1993, Sharon Rulin wrote a wonderful book on the problems around end-of-life care. In his obituary, the New York Times in 2004 said, in chiding physicians, Dr. Newland, a surgeon at Yale New Haven Hospital for 3 decades, pointed the finger at himself, confessing that on more than one occasion he had persuaded dying patients to accept aggressive treatments that intensified their suffering and robbed them of their easier death. Oh, and by the way, I was a chief resident in 1993 at Yale New Haven Hospital. So, of course, this is working great, right? We love this model. If things go really well, a medical student could actually spend 16 to 20 weeks in their discipline during medical school before they start residency. And at the end of that 4-year period, the Good Witch of the North waves her magic wand and voila, you're an MD. And then depending on what specialty you go in, you get to experience the joy of the 4-week block rotation, where during that time, you'll see a new and different attending every 7 days. And at the end of that 4 weeks, assuming nothing goes badly, Harry Potter waves a wand over you and you move on to the next rotation. This is akin to being Bill Murray in Groundhog Day. So folks, it's against this backdrop that we began to see the rise of the competencies. And since we're here in Canada, I think it's important to revisit something that was a very important event here. That was the Educating the Future Physicians of Ontario project that really flowed out of a doctor's strike in Ontario. And as part of this project, patient input was gained about what they really wanted from physicians. And this is one of the catalysts for the initial CanMeds work. And since that time, as well in my own country, we've had the rise of other competency frameworks. Ours as well was informed by multiple stakeholder interviews during the 90s. And we've had multiple reports on what's not working with regard to our healthcare system, with regard to our graduate and undergraduate medical education systems, from policymakers, more recently this report on improving diagnosis in medicine, the famous 100-year anniversary report on the Flexner report from the Carnegie Foundation, Ken Lettimer's recent book, and this is the report that Dave shared with you at the plenary. So I ask you, seriously, how many more reports do we need? This is just a smattering of some of them. And so perhaps, Dr. Walton, is this just one massive grief reaction? And I'd ask, where are all of you on this curve? Perhaps Albert Einstein said it best, insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. So dear critics, please explain to me why these things are so bad. Ensuring that our graduates can do what is needed for their patients and discipline, education that integrates patient and learner centeredness to achieve meaningful outcomes, responsible use of time as a resource, public accountability for medical education, proper focus on previously neglected competencies such as interprofessional teamwork, quality and patient safety, care coordination, communication skills, stewardship, and I could go on. What really strikes me about a lot of the reports that criticize competency-based approaches is that the word patient rarely shows up in them, or if it does, the patient's usually treated as an object and not the subject. I also think we have to stop engaging what I call false dichotomy and false absolutes. These make for great publications, but to be honest, to set up these issues as either-or arguments are not frankly very helpful to the folks on the ground who have to operationalize transformation in medical education. The checklist versus global judgment, reductionism versus holism, time. Of course, professional development takes time. Quantitative versus qualitative. Flexibility, variability versus standardization. Oh, and by the way, not all variability is particularly good, especially if you happen to be the patient. Work-based assessment versus standardized assessment, and pick your favorite one. I'd be the first to admit that implementing anything poorly is not likely to lead to a better outcome. But I also think that having these either arguments, when they really should be both-and arguments, is the most important thing. In closing, the story of Mary is actually the story of now. Mary's my mom, and she died in March. And the story I shared with you is honestly an abridged and complete version. And she deserved better. She really did. We all do. And I'm willing to bet every one of you in this room have had an experience either yourself or with a family member, or you've witnessed this in your own institution of dysfunctional and discompetent care. We can do better. And if you go back and thought about this in the 1980s, I think many of us would recognize that this discompetent, dysfunctional care would not have been acknowledged or even recognized. I think if we're going to meet 21st century healthcare needs of all our patients and populations, I think going back to the Hippocratic Oath from Louis Lasagna in 1964 is a really good place to start. This is a line from that oath that states, "I will remember that I am a member of society with special obligations to all my fellow human beings, those sound of mind and body, as well as the infirmed." Now, you may quibble with the nature of the words, but here's the bottom line. This applies to all of us in this room. If you do not think competency-based medical education provides at least a partial solution, then you have a special obligation to find something better. The public deserves nothing less. Before I lose it, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Walton. Thank you.
On the city station. Thank you, Eric, for sharing such a personal and intimate context for the important areas you've raised. Certainly, you've raised some interesting ideas, and now, to my chagrin, from someone who cheers for the Montreal Canadiens. Dr. Walton, how do we respond and address the challenges of competency-based medical education?
Well, thanks a lot, Jonathan. I should have pulled up a story about my mom, too, so because it's hard to beat that. But I'll do what I can. What I want you to all think about is implementation as we go through this. And there's a lot of what Eric is talking about is very right on, true, factual. But I want you to sort of take a pause before you drink the competency Kool-Aid. I have no affiliations. In fact, I'm a nobody. And I'm not sure how I got stuck up here battling this giant of medical education. I'm just a surgeon and a postgrad dean, and I have been a program director, so I'm going to come at it from that angle. In fact, I feel like Jonathan has tied me to the railroad tracks, and there is a train coming, and hence why I'm in the red team, because I'm going to just be a red splot soon. So I will do what I can to sort of bear a little bit of good judgment into this whole process and to sort of bring up some of the things that I know you in the audience are worried about competency-based training, what it means, how we implement it, how do we actually do it, how do I get everybody doing things. So that's kind of what I'm going to look at. As Eric, and I'll sort of run over this quickly, Eric alluded to how this started. You know, we always can tell how things are going to turn out depending on what they were based in. And I'll go back to what that Ontario strike was in 1986. And it was actually a strike that was ill-fated and based on the fact that doctors couldn't extra bill anymore. And this is where FPO and CanMeds came out of. It dealt with time-based problematic training and need for more flexibility. And it also, the idea, rightly so, competence will focus on the patients and it will be learner-driven. And sometimes that is a trouble Now, I want to make it clear that I am not supporting incompetence. And this is the seedy underbelly of CanMeds that we don't talk about very much. But CanMeds could make a resurgence with the 215 CanMeds version. So are we really in an area of incompetence? And clearly that story that Eric told was very touching, very sad, and we do see that. But you know, to be competent, is that really what we're aiming for? Is it because if you're competent, you're actually exceptional? And I would say, you know, just like we're in beautiful Vancouver, we should try and climb up Grouse Mountain as opposed to staying down in the foothills. Then it's about patient need. It's about the perception of society and the patients themselves. What is competence? What is competent to one person may be different to another. I hope you're not going to be like the other 20 incompetent doctors who couldn't find anything wrong with me. Is this who our present graduates are? Is this like the Three Stooges doing a Tosky? Or the preparation of a surgeon, and I would never do this, surgeon for surgery by having a good stiff drink? Is this really what our graduates are? I don't think so. I think actually we've been doing an excellent job in how we are training people. And there's lots of good things coming out of competency-based training that can be useful. But I don't think it's a disaster. So milestones are the basis of CBE. They look at significant events or stages in the life of a person based a lot in the pediatric developmental milestones that are important in terms of the first few years of life. We talk about a lot of small biopsies, a formative approach to these pulling the biopsies together, and workplace assessments. But as with many things, and when this first started, and I think it's still a problem, there are too many, too fractured, and we get into this real problem of can't see the forest for the trees. And I think that is a real problem. So as a result, we thought, well, let's do these EPAs and see whether they can package things together and be a useful approach to things. And in fact, that made a lot of sense to us clinicians that are trying to look at, you know, what do I do? You know, when I take out an appendix, how would I, when I entrust a resident to do that, what are the steps in that process? The problem, again, is the obsessiveness with of detail. And, you know, five EPAs turn into 50, and it becomes untenable. And then the idea is when there's a problem, you unpack the EPA and look at all those milestones and see where they're falling down. Again, problems. My idea is to keep it simple. Does anybody know what this is? So this was a 1970s TV show. And this was Grasshopper and his master. And they had one objective, to get out of that place. Because I don't know kind of how it was in the monastery. But all he had to do was take the pebble from the hand of his master. And that's how his one objective in terms of going on and starting his career as a kung fu master. And so that was his idea. Instead, we've got a situation where we have multiple milestones, multiple EPAs, and really it's quite daunting. Clinical medicine is a bumpy road. It's not this nice little cobblestone that we see or the hopping stones that we go along in terms of development within a career. And how do we equip our trainees for this bumpy road? How do we get them to avoid the potholes? Or to when they get into a pothole, how do they get out of it with relatively unscathed and their patients not scathed? I think that's one of the challenges as we go through this. And can we replicate this? So there's been a lot of talk. There was actually a very interesting letter to the editor that came into BMJ that I'm sure most of you are aware of in 2014. And there was a real cry that competency-based training was actually dumbing things down. There was a tick box emphasis. And it demotivated the learners and emphasis on minimal standards and not the excellence that we all should be trying for. It was about the assessment as opposed to the experience, that very very intense relationship between a trainee and their mentor. This certainly hit a nerve, and I won't read all these, but it struck a nerve with both trainees, but also staff physicians, where there was a concern about dumbing things down, average, mediocre, filling in logbooks, very bureaucratic approach to things, where creativity was not endorsed or supported. And then there's been a question whether CBE can actually do what we want it to do. Can it, you know, it might be good for driving curriculum, for looking at knowledge and skills, for the sort of more junior parts of a training program, but it can it replicate and assess clinical complex performance within the clinical realm? And I think that's not clear, and it's to be determined. I would say confusion reigns and compromise dominates this initiative. Milestones are one part of it. In exam committees, we're asked, instead of having checklists like we're supposed to have during the training, we're asked to sort of push ourselves towards global or holistic evaluations. So which is it and which would work better? We were initially told this was a time-free scenario that we could actually, and the ministries of health loved this, maybe we could push residents through faster and have them finish a five-year program in 3 years. Well, that led to a hue and cry amongst program directors and people like myself, program deans, who are trying to coordinate a system with scheduling nightmares. And so now we're told, well, it's okay, time is actually a resource that you can work with. The other thing that I've observed when I hear presentations about competency-based programs is that the reduction in time, if it does happen, is by limiting off-service rotations. And that may be very good because historically some of these off-service rotations have been terrible, have been really service-oriented and not serving the purpose of the training of the trainee or meeting the needs of their training for outcomes and taking care of patients. But I worry a little bit that programs will become siloed and there will be a lack of interdisciplinary awareness of what another discipline might do. So then we're told, you know, assessment is really driving this, it's really super important, and simulation is the answer. There's been many workshops here at this conference, looking at simulation and pre-conference meetings. And these are expensive. Deans just love these. There's lots of money required to support a sim center. And in some of the high fidelity initiatives, it almost reminds me a little bit of Frankenstein on the slab, with the control room being where the breaker gets turned in order to get Frankenstein going. And I'll come back to this because I think it is a bit of a problem. Then there's lots of visuals. How do we sell this? This is the Miller pyramid. How do we make it visually acceptable? And we start with 2D and then we go 3D, in terms of let's make it more complex and layer things in. And then we, we have... we have our esteemed Royal College. And as I pointed out, this is no free Wi-Fi. There's a lot of bells and whistles that come with this. And I draw your attention, actually, this is one of the early presentations of this. The Royal College tried to do a hostile takeover of the MD program, and with having junior and senior medical students. And this was beaten back by the AFMC, so now a later version of this no longer has the Royal College taking over the MD program. And I can see where competency-based training can work very well in the junior years as you sort of build a scaffolding of bringing residents through those early years. But I really wonder whether at the senior level, whether it really will be reflective and able to translate into, well, if we have to settle for competency, into practice. Just a few things about what this means for our faculty. It's paperwork, and I call it formitis. There are a myriad of forms that have been generated looking at every experience and how do we deal with it? How do our faculty deal with this? How do our senior residents deal with this as they look at junior residents? So the answer is we're going to digitize everything. We'll just make it all so it's all on your smartphone and your iPad or whatever, and it'll be wonderful. It'll all be at your fingertips and it'll be great. We all know that this doesn't always work. For one, and now our inboxes are just full of please complete this assessment form of the experience that you observed. And it also has led to what I call the zombie apocalypse. And I don't want to be, I don't want to be dramatic on this, but maybe I will. So what you're observing here is we see this in our hospitals, our clinics all the time. People head down walking, and sometimes they fall downstairs and they walk into walls. And what it leads to is a lack of interaction between people. And I think this is so important as we develop and our future experts in the fields, is that personal interaction. And I really worry about that. Are the expectations of our faculty too high? Are we expecting them to do too much? And we always say faculty development is going to be the answer. But again, is this too much? I'm a little worried about the Faculty of Medicine turning into a bunch of zombies, our program directors being over-challenged, and into a full season of the Walking Dead. This, I think we need to sort of rethink this in terms of application and implementation so that it's reasonable. And because I think it is going to get out of hand, and it in some ways it's already gotten out of hand. Will some of our faculty disengage? Lost my resident to competency-based education. And the response is, lucky you. You'll be out of here by 2, because those residents sort of slow you down. And I did some investigative reporting and found this picture. I've blanked out with advanced PowerPoint skills. poor innocent victims that are been part of this. I do look at the mannequin there looking somewhat zombie-ish in his own way. And I also look at perhaps the ringleader of this phenomenon. I also note that this ringleader has actually moved on to other things, realizing the dead-end version of simulation. So I leave those thoughts with you. I'm really worried about it, and the implementation is challenging. Thank you.
So there's been some punches landed, many shots that are below the belt, Knowing what? The two of you, not surprising. Dr. Holmboe, would you like to respond?
Yeah, I'll just make a couple points. I mean, obviously the concerns that Mark have raised are very legitimate. I too worry a lot about the faculty. I think we've created a job for them as becoming untenable. At the same time, I think, you know, it's really disturbing to me that we worry about giving our residents 30 minutes every 6 months, when in the previous 6 months, at least in our country, they spent, and let's go with the 70 hours a week instead of the 80, that would equal 1,820 hours, and we can't give them 30 minutes to let them know how they're doing. That's a system problem, right? That really is a huge system problem. I agree that if this just turns into a checkbox or checklist exercise, we lose. There are times when checklists make perfect sense and there's times they don't. And I think it's more about the proper implementation. And that's the other thing I really want to hit as a theme. I think this is a huge implementation issue, and I think Mark's concerns are right on target. We really have to be very deliberate and purposeful and really build in evaluation as we implement this. If we just drop it in and not continue to work with it and refine it over time, it's going to be a mess. We fully recognize that. So really looking at this through the lens of continuous quality improvement is just critical. Because we are dealing with a very complex profession. In fact, all the health professions are quite complex in what we do. I think there's also a lot of misconceptions around competency-based medical education. Still, the idea that it's training to a floor, it's not about training to a floor, or the kind of Dreyfus definition of competent, which is not exactly aspirational. It's really about ultimate mastery. And the question is, how do you get people on the right trajectory to get there? And we're going to have to figure that out. I think that's important. The other thing I think that we forget about is that this isn't just adding up a bunch of numbers. It really still involves a lot of judgment. How do we make sure our faculty have the skills and the time to do the judgment they need to do? Judgment matters. Even in our situation where we're using subcompetencies and milestones, they don't describe the totality of any discipline. They're the core. You know, they're a place to start. They're a framework on which to kind of base and work from. But man, there's a lot of white space around that stuff. Best example in the States is from pediatrics. When they originally made out their milestones, they had like 50 to 51 subcompetencies. It was untenable to do that many and report on, but it goes to show you the complexity of the discipline. And so, you know, getting it, I think, is going to be really important moving forward. And getting it kind of, again, the balance and not the kind of dichotomy, you know, this versus that, but how do we really use them in the most effective way? And then I just wanted to end with giving Mark at least some hope. I noticed you picked the Walking Dead as your metaphor, but I don't know, I really like the movie Warm Bodies with Nicholas Holt, and actually it turns out pretty well for him in the end.
Dr. Walton.
I'm very reassured that Eric has heard me. And I think it, you know, if I was to pull the room in terms of who has concerns about competency-based training, I would bet a vast majority of you would have some concerns. I think the theory is excellent. It's the implementation that's challenging. And it's challenging for our programs, from whether there's one resident in the program to 150 residents, as to how we do this and how we do it in a manner that's thoughtful, in a manner that really does invest time into that experience between a faculty member and a resident or a trainee. And I think that in the UK, that was seen to be a real problem with that quality time that wasn't spent. It was just a matter of filling in all the paperwork, getting all the forms done, and that really will defeat competency-based education. I do think we want to, and I'm reassured that we're not looking at the floor, but we want to make sure that we do aim for excellence. And I think if we aim for simply competence, we hopefully will achieve competence most of the time. But if we aim for excellence, then I think we're going to achieve competency for sure, and then we'll also get those future leaders that are excellent. There's concerns, I think, enormously with implementation, and some of the challenges are within, you know, say the Royal College e-portfolio, how that's actually going to look, and who will have ownership of that information. And I hope I've made you think a little bit about competency-based education in a critical but constructive way. The other part that I think is the Achilles heel of this is developing the faculty. And I don't know about in many of the faculties across the world, but faculty development is often the most under-resourced component of our faculties of medicine or faculty of health science, and yet we're still expecting an enormous amount of work to come out of them and to support this this initiative. I wore this hockey jersey on purpose, and you know, in Canada we're a large geographically, but we're small in numbers in terms of relative size. And we have strove for excellence within hockey and have, as a result, won world championships. And we really have sort of punched above our weight and gold medals. And it's because we went for excellence and certainly picked where we could do that. I'm going to use another film reference. I would say, just like Neo in the film The Matrix, one of my favorites, I would suggest you would choose the red pill and not the, and not the blue pill, because we know where that took Neo to. I also would suggest that the color blue this week has been a problematic color. We saw that in the federal election where kind of blue went down, you know, and it was kind of sad. We saw that even more sadly last night, where the Blue Jays wearing blue didn't quite make it. And so I think the future's red, we should really approach competency-based education with respect to what it can deliver, but also perhaps a little bit of skepticism, and we should push back a little bit where if we get encountered by a very bureaucratic approach to things. Because what we are wanting to do is develop a health-oriented training system that really would deal with some of the issues that Eric has so personally shared with us, because I think that's totally unacceptable. No one would accept that. So I think we're saying the same thing, but we want to make sure that you know, you go red, not blue. Thank you.
I wore some red. I want to thank Eric Holmboe and Mark Walton for challenging us with perspectives that address both sides of competency-based medical education. In the true fashion of being Canadian, I think we're going to call it a draw.
I'm so sorry.
Hopefully we've seen a narrative that suggests we understand an imperative to address the needs and the issues we currently experience in our clinical practice, in our medical education programs. Hopefully, as an attendee here at International Conference on Residency Education, you can discover more what CBM means and discover a little bit more of the what. But we'd all acknowledge the biggest challenge is the how. Implementation of these ideas to transform and to change our systems are not without considerable obstacles to be addressed. Let's work collaboratively to understand these, to work towards an improved healthcare system where the stories that we've all experienced as both professionals and as patients can be addressed so that we can provide our ultimate goal of medical education, good care for our patients. I want to thank you all for attending, but before we conclude, I'd like to invite Dr. Frank for some final comments on the morning.
That was outstanding, guys. Thank you so much. I'm so glad the blue won. What? Yesterday, I gave you a challenge for the ICRE selfie contest, and that's why I'm here. So I just want to thank all of these people, these outstanding selfies. Some of them very clever, some of them very picturesque. And it was lovely. What a great passion that you you demonstrated. And you seem to love Vancouver, and that makes us happy. We really enjoyed all of these. I want to put up my own selfie I had made last night. Here it is. Just a couple of us out last night. The light was very bright. Anyway, here's the winner. Will Simon Fleming come up? Here's your textbook, Simon. So you're about to go into your next session. Just want to remind you, if you could please use the app to evaluate this session. We'd love to give feedback to our wonderful presenters. And truly, you know, these guys are very sophisticated. They don't always talk like they're in extremes. And we'd appreciate your feedback on every aspect of the program. Here's how you can do it. And you can win $100 Canadian. I know. There's a great session on right now, all for all of us. We'll see you this afternoon at the next plenary.